We talked a little bit about tax benefits. So there's some incentives, right, to do this.
Yeah.
Maybe you can give us just your highlights of maybe the top three things that are unique when you sell your company on ESOP that you can't get anywhere else.
Well, there are tax incentives both for the owners who are selling and for the company that whose stock they're selling. And so for the owners, there's a provision of the code that was added in 1983, which is a like-kind exchange provision. So many of the listeners will know about a like-kind exchange in real estate.
Sure.
You take a piece of commercial property, you sell it, you make a profit, you reinvest that profit in other commercial real estate, and you don't pay tax on the first transaction, on that first sale, but you get a transferred tax basis in the replacement property. Mm-hmm. And so in 83, you're talking about corporate raiders earlier.
Yes.
That was all the rage at that point. And Congress was trying to offer business owners an incentive not to take that bait. And so they thought if we could offer this like-kind exchange and let them sell without having to pay long-term capital gains tax on their profits, then that might offer an incentive to slow down the corporate raider game. And it did. And so that's the first tax benefit that I think we often discuss with business owners. The next tax benefit is the ability to create a for-profit company that operates on a tax-free basis. And that sounds crazy.
Most people would say that doesn't exist, but it does exist.
But it does.
Right.
And, you know, Publix Supermarket is the largest 100% ESOP-owned company in the country, and they compete very well with Kroger because Publix doesn't pay tax, and Kroger does.
Yep.
And so the way that works is it's a combination of two things that many of our listeners will already know about. The first is in order to take advantage of the tax-free company structure, you have to be an S-corporation. So an S-corp is a flow-through entity. The company doesn't pay tax. It flows its taxable income through to its shareholder. The other thing that our listeners know about, but they don't ever think about this, is that a qualified retirement trust is a tax-exempt entity. And so at the end of the year, you don't get a 1099 for the earnings in your profit-sharing plan, and you've never stopped probably to ask yourself, why don't I? The reason is you don't own those assets. Those assets are owned for your benefit by the 401k trustee. So the same theory applies to an ESOP. We have a qualified plan trustee that's tax exempt. So what if we put those two things together? Company doesn't pay tax. It flows its taxable income through to its sole shareholder, which is a tax exempt entity. Voila, you have Publix, which is a business that operates like a church or a synagogue.
Right.
No tax on its income. So if you don't have that 40% tax leakage coming out of the business, imagine what that does for the value of the stock and for the value of these employees' retirement accounts. So that is an incredibly efficient and strong incentive for a company to do an ESOP.
Yeah, it's the best corporate finance tool out there that I can think of. If you're a company that is looking to invest and buy other companies and also do what an ownership group wants to do and set themselves up for the future and their employees, all that money is available to make investments, to pay off the ESOP participants. There's a lot of good that comes of it. And again, a lot of this is, you know, we didn't make this stuff up. Kelly and I didn't come around one day and say, oh, we're going to write this fun tax law. This all came in because of theory and in government incentivizing owners to do the right thing.
So one of the most common questions that I get, and probably the same for you, is a business owner says, well, these tax incentives are great, but this can't last.
Right.
Right? Congress is going to take this away. It's too good to be true. And what I tell them is, after having been in this business for 41 years, there have been a number of changes, but almost every one of those changes has been to enhance ESOPs, not to take anything away. And the reason for that is that ESOPs are one of those rare things that Republicans and Democrats can get behind.
Yes.
Republicans love the tax breaks for business owners, and Democrats like the wealth redistribution. So you have Bernie Sanders and the most conservative Republican in Congress all supporting the same thing.
Yep.
And that is so rare. And so is there a risk that the tax law is going to change? There always is. But history teaches us that it's not going to change to take away any of the ESOP tax benefits.
No, I agree with you. And all these things that we've talked about, that 1042 deferral, that was in 83. The S-Corp right. rules was in 2000. So if you think about it, every 20 years, something gets better
right.
in our world. So I
and
guess we're overdue. We're overdue.
We
know that there's some good positive things, but that's beyond the scope of our talk today.
Yeah.
The other thing you mentioned earlier, and I think this is another, maybe a third factor of the unique benefits of it, is the concept of, you said, sellers are sometimes involved in financing mm-hmm. these transactions, right? So they're essentially reinvesting in the business by giving the stock to the employees, but taking a note back for their proceeds and not getting all their cash. And a lot of the deals that we used to do, I was doing deals maybe not in 1979 because I was 10 years old and I was in grade school, no offense, but in the 90s, I had to do it. But in 2000, when they changed that tax laws, ESOPs were done in stages. They were all done 30,
right.
50, 100.
Right.
And then everybody went, oh, we're diving deep in. We're going to go head first in the pool. We're going to go 100%. The banks kept up with that for a while. If you remember, the old leveraged LBO days, those went away about 3 or 4 years after the S-Corp benefit. But we now had people in the community like you structuring the deal so that the owners not only would give their stock to the employees and get to 100%, take advantage of those tax benefits, but also would take back notes. And now there's equity incentives that are attached to those notes. So give us a little bit of a flavor of your perspective of how that equity incentive to the owners actually makes it more beneficial to them going forward.
Yeah, it's a second bite of the apple that's available in an ESOP transaction that's not available in a sale to a third party. And so the typical ESOP transaction might be financed with 40% bank debt, with no personal guarantee, and then seller notes for the other 60%. The seller notes are going to be subordinated to the bank debt. So the company is going to be able to pay interest only on the seller notes while the bank debt's outstanding. So since that is subordinated debt, and we all know a basic principle of finance is the higher the risk, the higher the return. So if the bank debt's at 7%, the seller note debt, since it's subordinated, might be at 14%. Most companies can't afford to pay 14% current interest. And so it might be structured so that it pays 6% current interest, with the rest of that 14% return coming in the form of warrants. So most people know how a warrant works, but just in case, it's a lot like a cashless exercise stock option. So the warrant's a financial instrument that's attached to the seller note, and it says that in the future, the holder of the seller note can exercise that warrant in other contexts for stock, but in the ESOP context, usually just for cash. And that cash is going to be designed to make that 6% current pay interest equal to 14% interest at the time the owner elects to cash in. And one of the really nice things about the warrants is that it is taxed at long-term capital gains tax rate, where the current pay interest is at ordinary income. So to give a business owner a perspective on this, oftentimes our clients receive 150% of the fair market value of the company because they're serving two functions. The first function is the seller, so they get paid 100% of the value of the company as the seller. Their second function is a financier of the transaction via the seller notes, and often the payment for that warrant is equal to an additional 50% of what they sold.
It can be, yeah.
So it's a great second bite of the apple, and it keeps the owner focused and invested in the future success of the company.
Yeah, and that benefits the employees, and it benefits exactly. the owner too. So again, we're getting to this win-win equation with all this complexity, but yet the theory is, it's very basic, which is benefit the employees, but also get a fair deal for that owner. And there's nothing wrong with that.
And it's actually better than win-win. It's win-win-win, yes. A win for the selling shareholder, a win for the company's employees, and a win for the company itself.
Yes.
Because it gets to operate on a tax-free basis.
100%. 100%. I don't know if you knew this, but I'm sort of a practice what I preach kind of person. And in 2021, I was a minority owner in a business, and we did exactly what you just said.
Yep.
So I have a little bit of a unique perspective. I'm a capitalist too.
Yes.
I enjoyed bringing the idea to my co-investors, and we did it as well. So it's been fun seeing that on the other side. We'll talk a little bit of some other war stories, but that was a good segue. The structure that you explained, I actually did one with the company that I owned, and it was pretty fun to watch.
It's awesome.
It was great.